Guys, welcome to Lunatic Astrology. I am your astrologer, Lori Lothi, and we're talking about the Ring of Fire eclipse, conjunct Betelgeuse and Mentkalanon fixed stars, and this is intense. And I've got Cupid here behind me because there's also an aspect about Cupid's arrow and love or companionship or connection and that which we fall for or fall in love with. One of my favorite songs is Johnny Cash's Ring of Fire, and I'm going to play it at the end of this video, just under 30 seconds so I don't get a copyright strike. So stay tuned for that. But I want to share with you guys that this is both a daunting eclipse for the collective, but it's trying to like purge, cleanse, and, you know, refine us. And it can be very auspicious and beautiful for you. I will tell you, I'm going to go through all signs. I want you to consider that the day of the eclipse, which is, you know, the 20th and 21st. So an example is on the 20th, it's at 11:42 or so PM Pacific time. So then it's in the middle of the wee hours, 11, 12, 1, you know, 2 o'clock, 11, 12, you know, 1, 2, 2 in the morning, you know, on Eastern Standard Time. So while the eclipse is in play, 24 hours and 24 hours before and after, really, just try your best in the window of that time to be peaceful, sattvic, calm, loving, kind. Don't let agitated feelings and emotions take over, and certainly don't do any actions that you will regret, because there's a stamp of energy that you put into place during eclipses, and it can play out in your life as sort of a melody of ick, you know, that you created during that eclipse. That's what, and don't look at the eclipse, no matter where you are in the world. Really, I believe the ancients had it right. It's not auspicious to look at the eclipse. Now, let's talk about the collective. If you don't want to hear about the mundane or the world story, please just jump forward and go to the all signs. But I suggest you just tune in to hear a bit about this. Now, before I tell you more, please like, subscribe, and comment. Then you'll get notifications when I post, and it helps me grow my channel. Second of all, I do have an eclipse sale on right now, and the link is down below in the description box. Want to know about how the eclipses are going to play out over your life over the next 2 years? And please check it out. This is the last eclipse that we're having today. Coming up this 21st, and then on July the 5th, two eclipses in the Cancer Capricorn corridor. So as I begin to explain this to you, I want to say that this is really a finale eclipse, a grand finale that we're all experiencing collectively, because the eclipses since basically July of 2018 have been going, creating a vortex of energy for all of us as a society and a culture and a world through the Cancer Capricorn axis. At the same time, Lord Almighty, we've been dealing with that chunk of Capricorn happening all last year. Jupiter's in Capricorn, Pluto, Saturn's just going back now into retrograde, but like the idea of South Node, like a huge chunky chunk of planets spent a lot of time in Capricorn over the last year, and particularly, of course, Pluto, Saturn, and right now Jupiter. So, I mean, it's been a time in which those eclipses, of course, have been moving through the part of the chart in the collective zone, Capricorn, of what? Of institutions, status quo, governments, the money system, the economic growth engine, the consumer capitalism of reality is still very Capricorn. And like, you can see that there's a disruption happening here. These eclipses, of course, go through this part of the chart in which it is the same alignment of the South Node going through Capricorn and the North in Cancer every 18 and a half years. So it's not brand new. But what's new is that Pluto Saturn conjunction that we're experiencing and have experienced there. And the last time they came together in Capricorn, it was the Black Plague. And so, yeah, and we got like COVID and the coronavirus pandemic. So what is being called forth, of course, is an attention to the North Node, which we've all been going through, which is Cancer. Love, self-care, tribe, home, nourishing, family energies, you know, Cancer, the great mother. And this eclipse at 0 degrees Cancer has some very interesting things to say to the collective. Yes, it's square Mars. Yes, it's square Neptune. I'm not going to go there. So many astrologers have. Technically, it's not a whole sign square. It's a whole sign trine in Hellenistic astrology. So I think there's some sweetness in this squaring energy. But where there's challenge for the collective is where the stars line up with this eclipse. So the two stars, Betelgeuse and I'm going to have to try to pronounce it, it's one of those stars I can't say, Mentkalanon, are both situated within 2 to 3 degrees, like 2 and 1.5 degrees of the eclipse. And you may know that this is a total eclipse. It's actually called an annular eclipse because it creates a ring of fire around the sun. You won't see it here. You could see it in India and Asia, parts of Europe. But nonetheless, that exists, that ring of fire. It's a very intense total eclipse when we have that particular way of showing up with that ring of fire. And add to that, the Betelgeuse and Menkilinan can be about war, at conflict. In case of Menkilinan, an eclipse in the constellation that it belongs to, which is the charioteer, can augur not only conflict and war ahead for the next 6 months, but also earthquakes. So we're in a time, you know, of that kind of energy with those two stars overlooking it, of some kind of calamity, perhaps. And you're no kidding, right? Now, I would predict that technically in places like the United States, that could just be riots and protests, and maybe even more so as the next 6 months go on and more people are standing up for things that they believe in, like the Black Lives Matter movement. But it can also be unrest and even civil unrest in ways that we can't quite see yet. And that may play out in the fall when Mars is going retrograde, perhaps, or just when he's in Aries, all Mars, the war god, is in Aries between June 27th and around early January, I think the 6th. So we've got that energy too. Mars is in his full power. Now, I think Mars in his own sign tends to try to find the noble and heroic aspects of being the martial warrior energy. So we can hope for some good causes, people stand up for some noble fighting. Now, Betelgeuse can be wealth, okay? It is the wealth star. And ironically, that means that in the collective, we may have a movement towards some kind of prosperity despite calamity in the next 6 months as this eclipse window plays out. I also am going to say that because that star has been waning in its brilliance, and a lot of scientists think it's going to go supernova sometime and look like as big as the moon, apparently, when it does that, I'm not sure it has its full Betelgeuse power, you know, like, whoa, you know, war, calamity, yada, 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 and also vast wealth. But it still has that those qualities to create those power, wealth, etc. And it is a military star. It is a red star, right? So it fits with that. Why am I talking about Cupid behind me here? Because I like to use trans-Neptunians, and the trans-Neptunian planet, in quotes, is Cupido, which is precisely across from this eclipse. It's Cupido is at 1.5 degrees of Capricorn. Now, Cupido takes 20 years to go through a sign in general. So, you know, it got into Capricorn 0 degrees early in 2019. I think it was around June, maybe May. And it'll be in Capricorn for 20 years. But what's auspicious and interesting to me is that this god of companionship and love, but also the arts, is in a direct opposition or being activated by this eclipse. So for the all signs, rather than just focus on earthquakes, calamity, and martial power, I will try to tie in a little bit of how Cupido may operate for you in your sign to bring you some new companionship or development in the creative arts. Now, also, I would like to say that the Sabian symbol for the 1 degree of Cancer is probably worth looking at, which I meant to do before we started and I didn't. So let me grab it. So, you know, the way the Sabian symbols work is you round the number up. And, you know, rounding the nut, I have my favorite book on Sabian symbols, which is 1 degree. Each degree of the zodiac has a downloaded, channeled Zen Koan kind of vibe. So Cancer 1 degree is a furled and unfurled flag displayed from a vessel. It's furled and then it's unfurled. That makes me almost think of like going to war and backing down from war. Okay, so as a collective omen, I kind of think that is a positive omen, but it could also mean somebody boisterously unfurling the flag of patriotism or nationalism. And maybe the flag unfurls because not just because there's a choice to sort of surrender or back down, but because something happens, you know, like a conquest. Historically, Betelgeuse activated by various factors like conjunctions to Pluto or Saturn or eclipses has triggered wars and warlike actions in the world. One of my favorite sites is Astrology King, and he talks about the mundane aspects of Betelgeuse. You might want to go look it up in terms of activations of various military actions historically. So I will say, I wouldn't be surprised if a military action of serious note happens over the next 6 months somewhere in the world because of this particular engagement of the eclipse on Betelgeuse or Betelgeuse, you know, however you would pronounce that word. All right, let's go ahead and talk about the all signs. I feel like there's not much else I can say other than, you know, duck, you know, stay home, stay safe, you know, be careful and all of that. Let's go to the signs. All right, we're going to tie in that Cupido. Let me get Cupido here. All righty, if you are an Aries, you're going to experience this particular eclipse in your natal fourth house. We want to look at the sun, moon, but particularly Aries rising. If you're an Aries rising, this eclipse in your natal fourth house is sure to bring about some sort of change over the next 6 months regarding your home, regarding the city you live in, maybe real estate. Now, I want you to remember that maybe for the last 2 years, you Aries have been dealing with things about home, moving, changing home, decorating home, fixing home, selling home, because these eclipses have been there since midsummer of 18, going through that corridor. And this is the grand finale, and it will play out for roughly 6 months after the June 21st eclipse. But Cupido is now opposing or in a relationship to this eclipse. So maybe for you Aries, sun, moon, and ascendants, you could find something going on in your life where, just ponder this possibility, relocating and moving or changing your home is connected to love. It can also be connected to the arts, right? Cupido rules our creative expression. Do you need to move to somewhere that satisfies your sense of beauty, your sense of love, your companionship, your in-loveness in life? And it's possible that, you know, a new relationship could be triggered because of this eclipse, you Aries, sun, moon, and ascendants. Ah! Excuse my alarm. So there you go. That's an omen for yes. A ring of fire, you know, down, 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 burning ring of fire. I will play that song at the end of this. Actually, I should have played it already. Oh, darn it. Okay, so next of all, we go to the Tauruses of the world. You guys are experiencing third house eclipse action, which has been going on for the last year, 2 years almost. This is July of 2018. The eclipses have been going through your third and ninth house. So I want you to consider that this eclipse is going to maybe have something to do for you, Taurus sun, moon, and ascendant particularly, with the third house themes of siblings. Maybe with local buddies and people you hang out with in your neighborhood. Sometimes the third house is aunts and uncles. And it could also be about your own creative expression when it comes to things like writing or teaching or speaking or educating. And if you're in the oracular and divinatory arts, this is the sign of the goddess, right? And moon is in its joy in the sign of the goddess, where we find the oracle divination tools in the third house, going to see the oracle of Delphi, the oracle of Apollo. And so even though it's an eclipse, the moon is present because it's conjunct the sun in that third house of yours. So it's kind of a moon in its joy, has some benefits for you. Now, third house with an activation from Cupido during this eclipse in the 6 months that follow, I wonder if you Taurus people are going to focus on a local love story, somebody in your neighborhood, being introduced to a new potential partner of destiny through a sibling. Are you going to do something creative and artistic in writing, teaching, and speaking and communicating that really will be celebratory in terms of Cupido can bring us in touch with a level of artistic refinement and talent and ability within ourselves that we may not have experienced before? So those are some ways to think about that. And short-term trips and travel, like going on a jaunt somewhere, you know, local or within your state or country, certainly not foreign. And so there may be in the 6 months that follow Taurus, sun, moon, and ascendants, a trip that is extremely connected to the themes of new beginnings, it's a new moon, but also love and companionship and artistic expression with Cupido. It's kind of like the god of artistic culture activating that part of your chart. So trips could be very auspicious over the next 6 months, especially given the moon is in its joy in an eclipse there, new moon, new beginnings, etc. All right, now let's go ahead and talk a little bit about Gemini. Gemini, you're going to be experiencing this eclipse in your second house of earned income, self-worth, self-value, self-possession, things that you own that make you resourceful. You know, your possessions and belongings, all of them, you know, the art in your home, etc., are second house. It's also things that you would eat or put in your mouth, you know. It's also your voice, things that you might want to say. So that said, Gemini, sun, moon, and particularly ascendant, we're looking at the tail end, the finale, the end result of what's been a two-year journey of eclipses through this part of your chart. And so we're just kind of finishing up the story. And this time we're doing it, of course, with that energized, you know, warrior star energy of Betelgeuse and Menkilimnon. And we've also got the vibration of Cupido. You want to go into like a warrior mode for your money. Are you going to upgrade your money? Are you going to go fight for your money? Are you going to get into like action hero mode for how you can be more resourceful in your life, Geminis, and make more money? And can you do that with some blessings from Cupido? You know, Cupido will be like looking at you across the way from your eighth house of wealth and other people's money. And so maybe you can get some wealth through other people's money this time, like spousal money, bank money, bank loans, mortgages, investments, you know, stock market investments even. So it's not a time to take speculative risks per se. I'm not saying that, but I'm saying, Geminis, this is a time for harnessing some more money in your life in a way that is going to benefit you over the next 6 months and finish up the two-year cycle, which you've probably been struggling to figure out your money story and your wealth story and your resourceful story. But I think with Cupido there, and plus, you know, even though Betelgeuse is a hard warrior star, it can be, it does mean wealth. It is the wealth star, you know? So you've got the wealth star activating with Cupido in your money house. Wow. So I'd say, yeah, it's good for your money over the next 6 months, Geminis, sun, moon, and risings. All right, next I want to talk about, obviously, the order. We're in astrological, zodiacal order. This is intense for you, you Cancers. This is the last of the eclipse for Cancer rising, sun and moon people. It's the last of the eclipses of the last 2 years, finishing on a grand finale on Betelgeuse. Woo! And Menkilinon, warrior stars, and activating the Cupido, passion for somebody, love, companionship, and artistic expression, creative expression, and beauty. All of that is on your identity. It's in your first house. That's who you are. So are you going to pull out all the stops and bring yourself to a new sense of self-companionship, self-love, self-respect? And can you be noble and beautiful and powerful and almost like this, you know, extraordinary star energy that's happening here for you on this eclipse? It's almost like I see you Cancer, sun, moon, and rising being able to rise up to a new level of self-empowerment. Now, it can also be difficult if you know, in some ways it's on your ascendant, that's your physical body. So more than ever, it's time to Cupido up your body, super self-love, fall in love with your body, treat it well, eat well, exercise it, do what you need to do. You know, it's a new beginning because it's a new moon, you know, all total eclipses of solar eclipses are new moons. So a new beginning as well for your body and its wellness, etc. It will be activating your seventh house because that's where Cupido started going through June of 2019, the god of love, falling in love, Cupid's arrow. If you're single, Cancer, sun, moon, and rising, this eclipse certainly could trigger a new love in your life over the next 6 months and you will be falling in love. That arrow of Cupid, the son of this, where is he? The son up there of Aphrodite doesn't play around with love. He just hits that arrow into your heart and next thing you know, you're smitten. So you Cancer ascendants, sun, moon, get ready. Now, if you're with somebody and you're married, okay, well, if you don't fall back in love with each other, Cupid might be up to some mischief and bring an alternate character into the story that might distract you from that long-term committed love. So if you can't juice up the love factor, the in-love factor in your current relationship, I'm not promising you that Cupid's arrow won't strike regarding somebody else in your life. I'm just going to say it's possible over the next 6 months. Moving on. Leo, 12th house is where this eclipse happens. This is not new. Eclipses have been going through your 12th house for the last 2 years, since midsummer of 2018. So it's a deeply spiritual placement. I don't know how it's felt, but it's soulful. It's a house of spiritual liberation and enlightenment. It's a house of your dreams at night, your past lives. I wonder if this has been a very profound spiritual journey of the last 2 years. It's intense because your 12th house where this is happening is, you know, not just from this life, you know, it's other places and times. You know, you may have not quite been in touch just with this reality over the last couple of years. Now, the eclipse for you Leos in the 12th house is going to activate the last finishing touches on whatever this journey has been for you guys to activate some goodness from your past lives, some juice out of that house, because this means that the south node has been in your sixth house. I'm just really tuning in because I've gone through, you know, a lot of energy of eclipses as well in my 12th house, and it's been challenging, but for me, it's the south node eclipses. For you, it's the north. I just want to say that one of the things you might consider, having had to journey through this 12th house energy, is where can you pull out your spiritual gifts from a prior life? Do you feel like maybe you've got talents or cities or spiritual abilities, powers, so to speak? Because Betelgeuse is power. And that eclipse is saying, what are your powers here? What is your spiritual wealth? And maybe you're not just a muggle. What specialness do you have? So that may become apparent to you. Now with Cupido activated as well, it's a karmic axis. And if you're a single one, Leo, Sun, Moon, and Ascendant, you also may be in the next 6 months ready to meet a partner of destiny, a divine complement. I like to use that word, divine complement. A client gave it to me rather than twin flame or soulmate. But you singletons might be due for that. Cupido, the eclipse, Betelgeuse, power, love, energies all combined. What a mashup. Coming out of the past life corridor of the chart, the karmic axis could be a very important soulmate coming your way. Look at Cupid's arrow. He's shooting into the sky for you. All right. Virgo, ascendant, sun and moon. The energy of the eclipse is going to occur as it has. These eclipses have been going through this part of your chart for 2 years in your 11th house. Now, your 11th house is the house of good spirit. It's considered a positive and fortunate house in the ancient tradition, but it is your friendships and your alliances, the people you want to spend time with in the larger context of your life, like memberships, belonging to social groups, social circles. You know, you may have had to disconnect and let go of certain combinations of friendships that no longer work, or memberships or belongingness. You know, oh, I belong to the sorority. Oh, do you anymore? Did the eclipses knock that out? Bet you they did. Because the eclipses will change what they touch, but for the better. So you've had a wholesale renovation of what you consider to be your tribe over the last couple of years. And, you know, the 11th house is your hopes, dreams, and wishes. And I bet you've changed what you think you want in your life. I bet you that's been also changed up quite significantly over the last 2 years. So I'm going to say that is the final touch of that with Cupido activated. I'm wondering if you have a sense of falling in love with a new circle of friends, of being completely also in love with a new direction in your life, a new hope or dream or wish. Now, this is also a romantic energy in the sense that Cupido himself has been going through your house of falling in love and your house of children and pregnancy and stuff. Cupid's arrow may strike. Well, there he is again. A romantic chord for you over the next 6 months. If you already have someone, you could fall more deeply in love and commitment. If you're looking to have a baby, you might have Cupid's arrow, actually, like the penetrating, you know, energy of that hit your womb or your whatever, if you're the guy, the womb of your loved one, and create a pregnancy. So be cautious if that's not what you want. But Cupido can also bring some creative expression because he is the god of art and love as well. So artistic and beautiful and art and creativity, that could show up in your life as well. So more creative expression, more business projects too. Fifth house that have power and ability to generate wealth. We can't let the wealth piece go. Betelgeuse is actually the star of wealth, and so great wealth. So anything you want to do as an independent enterprise could bring you great wealth. Ah, my, I'm just about to decharge. Well, I got 10% left. I think I can make it through this. Looked at my battery. Okay, next. Libra, you guys are looking at this happening at Libra ascendant sun and moon. This is happening in your 10th house of career. Now, over the last two years, eclipses have been shifting your career agenda, trying to change it up. What do you want to do? Who do you want to be? What do you want to show up in as in the world? It's also been anchored in the fourth house of home. That could also be a change of home or desire to change home. Now this is the final touch, the big hurrah. With the eclipses doing that angular relationship to career and home, especially given that Betelgeuse is a wealth star, could be a very opportune time to sell a home. Particularly given, I will say, that the real estate market will correct in 2021, most likely. So we're at the end of that. The North Node going through Cancer is classically an escalation and upswing in the real estate markets. And that is finishing. This is the last of those Cancer Capricorn eclipses. So getting wealthy from selling a property for some of you Libras could be sun, moon, and ascendants could be an auspicious choice over the next 6 months, as well as you're going to experience that Cupido in the 10th house, falling in love with your work, falling in love with a new work, falling in love with a new job, falling in love with a new career direction, passion, engagement with a new career direction over the next 6 months. Anything else? That's about it. Well, Cupido could say beautify your home, but I'd sell it if you could. If you could sit on cash, I'd do that. All right, Scorpio, 9th house is where the eclipse actually occurs. Check my battery. And I would say for you guys, this is going to be about foreign lands. I think you're going to activate something out of a foreign land. This is classic 9th house. Could be campuses and universities as well, you know, colleges and stuff like that. So Scorpio, sun, moon, and ascendant. There's goodness for you in the house of book publishing, 9th, foreign lands, and higher education. And also it's a house of soul or the house of God, spiritual truth, spiritual wisdom. So the eclipse is actually happening in that house, and it means it's activating the 3rd house as well of your local neighborhood, short-term trips and travel. The south node in the local zone, the 3rd house, could be a sign to let that go and move on to, I'm sorry guys, moving on to like the foreign energy for some reason. Or if you're doing some kind of business, this is your international reach. Or if you're a book writer, this is also the international reach in the context of book publishing. Okay, I am going to go plug in my laptop so I don't lose this recording. Give me a second. Coming back. Okay, I am back. All right. So those themes are intense, Scorpios. Again, if it's not like you're going to move to a foreign land, thank you, Eclipse, you may have a journey to a foreign country or a pilgrimage or a soulful trip of some sort, very 9th house. Also guides, mentors, and people who would mentor you, basically, spiritual teachers or just practical teachers and mentors can come out of the 9th house. So if some of you Scorpios are looking for some kind of mentorship and something that you're passionate about, Cupido, that excites you, that you're in love with, a talent, a hobby, a skill, this is a time where over the next 6 months, this eclipse could bring something in for you in that regard. Now, this is a wealth star, independent of the military component. Betelgeuse brings wealth. So could you have wealth through something to do with foreign lands, campuses, mentorship, education, and book publishing and the theme of international, okay? I think so. moving on. I'm forgetting where I was. Sagittarius. Okay, so you beautiful fire Sagittarius, this is going to be an eclipse. It's occurring in your 8th house. This is the house of death. This is the house of your money that belongs to other people, spousal, credit cards, bank loans, investments, derivative incomes, royalties. It's the kind of money you don't get by, you know, working and charging money for it. It's not a paycheck or a salary. So you're having a wealth conjunction with Betelgeuse, okay? A star that means wealth and power. on this new moon, new beginning eclipse. So very simple interpretation for Sagittarius, sun, moon, and rising is that this is going to inaugurate maybe a 6-month window of time in which you're likely to experience an uptick in your wealth. You can also get wealth out of the eighth house, by the way, through anything that you sell, including real estate. So there's that, stocks and real estate. If you invest in some stock, it could take off like a rocket ship over the next 8 months. Wait till the market bottoms. It's not nearly bottomed out. Cash is king. Oh, I just got a notice that my speaker, default speaker changed. I hope I didn't lose a speaker. That's not good. I mean, a sound quality thing. All right, I'm just going to keep going. I still have a microphone plugged in, so I hope nothing happened there. Yikes, talking into the wind. Yeah, I see that my mic is working. Okay. What else do I want to say, Sagittarius? The eighth house is the house of death, and an eclipse is eclipsing something. Sun, moon, eclipse in the eighth house of death. I don't normally say this, but I'm going to say possibly somebody you know could pass in the next 6 months if that happens. It could be good for your money, like an inheritance. And I'm also going to say that it could be also good for a spiritual rebirth. I mean, there's a quality of the eighth house is like we go to the underworld and we come back out reborn. So it could be a very intense time, Sagittarius, sun, moon, and ascendance for a rebirth spiritually. And with Cupido there, there's a promise of something, Cupido opposing that from the second house of money, that you're going to rebirth into something that brings you great joy and passion, especially around money. All right, moving on. And your voice, because the second house is what you have to say or message the world. So Cupido's going through that part of your chart, maybe giving you a new voice, a new message of some sort. All right, Capricorn, seventh house eclipse. Don't forget, the end, tail end of a 2-year journey of eclipses through the house of marriage partnership. It's also the house of business partnership. And if you work one-on-one, it's your clients. Now, I wonder if for you Capricorns, this isn't going to be a refreshment in the love story, because Cupido is activating it. Exactly, a new beginning, a new eclipse, power, wealth, love, Cupido juice in your marriage. So if you're with somebody and it's been a struggle, you Capricorn sun, moon, and ascendance could have a renewal. And if you're a single Capricorn, this could be somebody new that you fall in love with, madly, crazy, wild, passionate, but you want to marry the person. And that encounter would happen over the next 6 months. Now, if you work with clients, you may become infatuated with a client. It could be also infatuated with new clients or a new cadre of people, the others you work with. Good for business partnerships as well, Capricorns, if you're passionate about that partnership, if it makes you excited, if you can't wait to spend time with that person or people, all right? Don't sign a contract unless you're completely excited with the idea, but over the next 6 months. I'm having it's humid and or it's hot in Montreal. I've got big hair. Alrighty. Last, almost but not least, the last two, Aquarius and then Pisces. Okay, Aquarius, that's me. I'm an Aquarius rising. Aquarius risings are ascendant, sun, moon. You guys are experiencing the eclipse, powering up a lot of energy as it has been for 2 years now in your sixth house of health and regimes for better health, like how to avoid being sick by eating properly and exercising, protocols for wellness. It's also, and yes, I've been on a cleanse. I've been on several cleanses. I'm no longer a wine drinker, it seems. You know, it's been an incredible 2-year journey to get rid of self-undoing and bad habits. Now, also, this is a house of true calling and right livelihood, because it is where we have bhakti, which is devotion or service, in order to achieve moksha or liberation in the 12th house. So when we can let go of the servitude in our lives and the duty and replace it with service and destiny, we begin to move in a greater flow with our dharma. And part of what that 6th house offers is that promise of not just my job, but my calling. You know, I love that feel, because the eclipses have put me in touch with that over the last 2 years as well. I mean, I moved to full-time astrology, lunatic astrology. I also teach courses online that bring me great excitement to do with various things, like do what you love with the magic you're born for. And so, because I learned that and I teach what I learned. So you guys, you Aquarius risings, you're going to have like some grand finale energy here in the sixth house. Now, it is a house of karmic debt. So if you've been paying off some karmic debt over the last 2 years, since July of 18, this is the final touches on your debt relief program. With Cupido being active, and it's a house of right livelihood, what is possibly going to show up in your life in terms of artistic, creative, cultural expression, and or in love, Cupido, regarding your calling? Could you meet somebody that facilitates a greater push towards your passionate purpose in life or your calling in life? Could you meet somebody in the workplace? Sixth house can be your practical, I go to workplace, and you could fall madly in love with that person thanks to Cupido, and this would be a very karmic relationship. For all of you Aquarius risings, any new relationship this beginning, literally the eclipse is on the 21st, right? So you're going to back that up for 2 weeks before the eclipse, 2 weeks after, and then 6 months is a longer term unfoldment. Any new relationships that begin during this time are extraordinarily karmic, and I would say, like, look at it as a blessing likely because of Cupido. And Betelgeuse, it means you can meet a wealthy partner, or the two of you could create wealth together or power together, you know, so that's really exciting too. With the kind of Menkilinan there, which is the charioteer's shoulder, which is conquest energy, it could be quite the exciting, powerful romantic connection in which the two of you feel like you could conquer something together, like conquer the world, or, you know, set out on a path to serve the world or do something good for the world, because it is the house of service. And I don't think there's anything wrong with serving the world as a couple. It's one of my dreams, actually, to be with somebody and feel like we are serving the world together. It hasn't happened yet, but I'm waiting for that because I'm single. I'll let you know how it plays out. The last thing and never least is my watery Pisces ascendant sun and moon people. A lot of Pisceans in my life. So this is your natal fifth house of romance, children, creative expression, independent business enterprise, luck. It's a place where you can really shine and be inspired in your life. And these eclipses have, you know, finally finished up their journey through your fifth house. And I would say that your fifth house energy is, it's a house of luck. And you've got a Betelgeuse wealth star there. Hello, wealth and power in a house of luck finishing up. The other eclipses didn't have Betelgeuse there. So I'd say, because it's fifth house speculation, it's time to play the lottery just for the next 6 months, particularly the 2 weeks before and after this eclipse. Why the heck not? You could become vastly wealthy in a stroke of luck. It depends on the rest of your chart, of course. I have a reading called Harness Your Lucky Stars, but it's not active right now. But I mean, there are factors in a chart that show where your luck resides. But as a general principle, Pisces, sun, moon, and particularly ascendants, it's a good chance to take a speculative risk around money. It could pay off. Don't bet the house on it. Be playful and have fun with the idea of a lucky financial break over the next 6 months. Now, it is also your children. So your children could also have some good things happen. Power, Betelgeuse, they could become quite wealthy, power and wealth. Cupido is angling in from your 11th house. Your 11th house is your hopes, dreams, and wishes, being passionate about a hope, dream, and wish, but it's also your larger social circles and networks. And if you're online with a business, this is expanding then. Cupido could bring a blessing of Cupid's arrow to bring great passion to expanding your Cupid's arrow. I got to point at him. Cupid's arrow. Oh my God, it's so hard to do it reverse. Expanding your social circles and bringing you great goodness in that area of online world, media, social circles, tribes that you belong to. If you're a single Pisces, sun, moon, or ascendant, because this is on the axis of romantic love, the fifth house, and you've been waiting for a partner, destiny, and it hasn't shown up over the last 2 years of eclipses here, given that we have Cupido only literally a degree and a half opposite this eclipse for the first time ever for you, this is a very strong omen or auspicious energy around falling madly in love with a true partner of destiny or a divine compliment sometime over the next 6 months. I'm going to stick with that for you, single Pisces. If you're with somebody, it could renew the energy. It is a house of play, fun, and sexuality, the fifth house. If you want to have a child and Cupid is playing a game of striking an arrow into the fertility story, this would be a time in which that could happen. Cupid does things quickly, right? Like the arrow goes in and boom, there's something happening. So if you don't want a child, be cautious. All right, we're done. Now I'm going to play the Ring of Fire that I promised, which I meant to play earlier, and we're going to finish up. I'm only going to do a snippet because I'll get a copyright strike. Ring of Fire, we're finishing up. Don't forget, like, subscribe, comment, please. Get notifications when I post. I have an Eclipse special link down below. You might want to grab an understanding of the Cancer, of the Gemini, Sag eclipses that are going to start playing out through your next 2 years and how they will unfold a new story in your life. All right, let's play a snippet of my favorite Ring of Fire.
Love is a burning flame, and it makes a fiery rain. Bound by wild desire, I fell into a ring of fire.
Okay, I just got under the 30-second copyright strike, I hope. Oh my God. I'll kick myself if I'm not under 30 seconds. Alrighty. It probably was like 31 seconds. Shoot. Cross my fingers on that, guys. Alrighty. I'm not going to worry about it. Ciao, ciao. I've got to end the recording. Give me a sec. I've got too many screens up.